community as a method, how we do what we do. Here, of course, we're really talking about in many ways what might be the most distinctive element of the therapeutic community, and that is how essentially it uses a social psychological environment that we will call a community, and in effect asks the question, how do you use community, and we'll define that in a moment, to essentially accomplish the objectives of treatment, which are to change the whole person, change lifestyles, change identities.
Emotionally compressing, and you feel yourself as you're doing it, your true living self, your spirit gets wound up tighter and tighter and tighter and tighter. All right? Everybody, can everybody see that?
When I was 11 years old, my mom was a drug addict, and I was like, if you ever went to dope houses now, you'll notice there's always kids, like people that come over to dope houses, put their kids in the room. And I was one of those little kids that kick back in the other room while everyone's in the living room getting high. And one of these guys, I was friends with his little brother, Packy. He was 15, Danny was. Packy was my age, he was about 11. And so we'd stay over there like when my mom would be doing her shit. And we'd all sleep in the same bed. And I ended up getting fucked in the ass by him a couple times. I think because of it, I'm a real fucking sexual degenerate. You know, like ways that I wouldn't get off with normal sex. I'd have to like envision stabbing people or the person I'm with. Like that would get me off.
Do you want to go over there and talk to Eric? No self-worth. Just sit down right there in the back of your home. Okay. Okay.
Just listening to everybody talk and stuff and seeing all the, you know, just made me feel, I mean, tied it straight into rape. You know, I lost my identity. I had, you know, everything on there.
Right. A lot of these kinds of situations really bring out is the dark side.
Well, who are you, man? You can't
come on,
switch
Emmett.
It.
Sit.
Hey, check this out.
Sit down, man.
You need to sit down and learn.
I'm gonna let this group get safe for you right now.
Hey, Emmett, fucked up.
This is where the hard work begins.
Okay, well.
All right. The difficult thing then comes to push through that and keep pushing toward the things that you have done that you don't like, the things that have made you feel bad, the pain that you have caused others.
See, this program that fucked me all up and gave me some goddamn fucking morals where I feel something about a motherfucker before I didn't give a fuck. And now I see this dude crying, I'm like, God damn.
So he brought you back to when you were...
He took me back to when... I'm wondering, how did that guy do... How's that guy feeling that I did that too? I felt guilty because I have raped a man before. You see what I'm saying? Me and my homeboys raped a man before in prison. And I never knew that a person could be so mentally fucked up behind it.
All right, so then how did that make you feel at that moment, man? And what did you picture in your head?
At that moment?
You avoided that question.
His face, how he looked, the look of surprise when we caught his punk ass slipping and rushed up in there on him. The fear on his face.
Was he crying?
He did cry.
So what did the sounds like? What did it sound like when was he screaming? Was he kind of like
he screamed when if I move my the fucking shirt off his mouth or the pillow or whatever we had on it, a blanket or one of them state blankets we had on his fucking mouth. Them was screams of pain, man. There was muffled screams of pain. Like, whoa, motherfucker, you hear what I'm saying?
I hear what you're saying. But that's the part you need to deal with. That's the part that you don't want to hear. Feel yourself, know yourself about the shit you put on this kid, man.
Well, probably the phrase that best summarizes the actual therapeutic community approach. We've been talking about the perspective, but now the actual approach. The phrase that summarizes that is one that we've been using for a number of years, and that may be called community as a method. Now, we have communities everywhere we look. We have communities in schools, we have communities in organizations, you have communities in neighborhoods. Generally, you know, the sociological definitions of community usually emphasize the idea of shared norms, shared objectives, or shared interests. So people who are sharing these can often say we're part of a community. And that's not wrong, but it emphasizes the issue of shared. And of course, therapeutic communities are also communities because they have some shared. They share, and their sharing rests on the idea of we are all here to change our lives. So that's what essentially defines it as a community. But that doesn't define it as community as a method. The real step forward in terms of therapeutic community as a contribution to social psychological treatments, certainly, has been the use of the community as a method for changing human behavior. In this sense, the therapeutic community makes its most distinctive contribution to social psychological treatment. Using a community as a method. So it isn't simply that we're here together to change our lives, but that's first, that defines us as a community. But now there are certain components of this community which have to be there in order to essentially accomplish the goal of changing lifestyles and identities. That's what we mean by community as method. Now, there are a lot of ways to really have this discussion. One simple introductory statement that I often use when I talk about the concept of community as method is the following. Community as method refers to an individual who learns to use the community to change themselves. Very frequently, when a client comes into treatment, that idea is expressed in very similar language. You come here, and in many ways, this community exists to teach you to use the community to change yourself. Therapeutic communities, while they're using a powerful community as method approach, they really exist for the individual. Let's talk a little bit more in more detail about what we mean by community as method. For one, a community is a method when it provides the context for the individual. Context really refers to kind of a collection of social and physical factors, all the relationships, as well as all of the activities that are set up for the day or the week, in many ways, is the context. In this context, in this kind of social psychological environment, that context is to be used to change the individual. So the first component of community as method is that it provides the context for change.
Monday I found out I had hepatitis C. Fucked me up. I said I wasn't gonna cry. So I come running down here. Where's Millie? Because if anything happens since I got here, it's, you know, I want to see my girls, my group, because I love this group thing. I love it. And Carol gave me a pamphlet on it, and Deanna, Mildred, Shauna, all the girls was right there for me.
So the individual doesn't go out anywhere. They don't go to another school. They don't go to another treatment program. They don't get any other service down the block. They stay here and living in this setting with other people, and living with the daily activities of the therapeutic community, it's in here that all the change is essentially begins to unfold if the individual uses that entire context. So community as method, if essentially provides the exclusive setting where the individual can change. Well, But that's only the first component. It's a method when not only do we provide the context for change, but we also, the community itself, sets the expectations for change. Expectations generally imply some kind of covert demands made on individuals, standards of how they should in fact participate in the community. So community is a method in therapeutic communities. Community is the method because it sets the expectations for how individuals participate in the community.
It's like when I first came up in this mud, I told Tara, because we from the same county, and I was telling her, fuck that shit, I'm just gonna do time. And you know what I'm saying? I shouldn't have lied. God damn, I should have just turned myself in. She seen me from the stay. She seen me run on my stay. She seen me come back. And it was like, fuck that. And then she told me that I had to come to group and say all kind of bullshit. I told her, fuck that. I got to give a gab. I'm just going to lie. She said, you know they going to know. No, they ain't. I'm just going to lie. And another thing you kept telling me, you'll get that shit, you'll get it. Mm. No, I ain't fuck that. They just got you programmed.
No, they don't.
Shit, last month, I got the shit. I'm serious as fuck. I'm serious as fuck. I'm like, you know, fuck, it's like different things if you just be here, you'll get something out of it and shit. And I was like, fuck, I don't want to do that shit. I don't want to be doing pull-ups. I don't want to do none of that bullshit. I don't even want to share my story. The other day, they had to cut me off.
Now, when you think about expectations of being kind of implicit demands, very much like parents set expectations, they are basically setting up some kind of an implicit demand, sometimes explicit demand. But often the child may feel this is what my parents want of me, you know what I mean? Or they, when we talk about parents expecting you to go on and go to school, they may never even say that, but the individual somehow has this understanding that this is, there's some kind of a demand being made, not in the overt sense necessarily, but in very implicit ways. So this idea of kind of implicit demands or overt expectations in terms of standards, and this is how you participate in this community if you're going to change, helps to define this second very, very important component of community as method. You not only use this whole context for change, all relationships and all activities, but there are standards of how you should participate in this community in order to use it appropriately.
If you want to phase up, you have to be a productive citizen of this community.
When we came into the Phoenix house, we all was assigned a big sister. And what the big sister does is they show us around and teach us what we have to do. And everything that they've learned here, they shared it with us.
Community as a method is not only context and expectations, but it's also when the community is constantly evaluating or assessing whether the client is in fact meeting expectations. So you have now three components. Here's the context, here are the expectations for how you should participate in this community, and we are constantly going to be assessing or evaluating whether you're in fact meeting those expectations.
The thing that I want you to be able to take a look at is that we will never ever buck you down for doing something that is constructive in your program. But you choose not to even come and ask. And you know, and I don't know what that's about.
And then finally, community is method when not only is it assessing whether clients are meeting expectations, constantly evaluating that, but when they finally respond to the individual in terms of its own assessment. That is, if the client is in fact meeting expectations, that's what the community assesses, then the community will respond to that. often in positive, encouraging ways.
You know, I don't have no immediate family. All I have are my brothers, and they're all doing what the hell they want to do. It's about me today. This is, you ladies are my family. But you're going to be all right, Sasha. You're going, because I see it in you. You have something. And I know you want this. Just from how excited you were this morning when you said you're going to school to be a drug and alcohol counselor. I was like, that's right. It's not enough drug and alcohol counselors in the field. And I think you got that. I think you have what it takes.
If the client is not meeting expectations, according to the community's own assessment, then the client essentially will be responded to by the community, maybe corrective ways.
I don't like the way you look at me sometimes, you know? Yeah. I don't. It makes me very uncomfortable.
I mean, if you fucking come on this property and you fucking were told not to flirt with the women, then what the fuck are you doing?
I wasn't flirting with them.
Well, you told me. Do you have any fucking idea how hard it is for a woman to fucking clean up after she's been through a lot of shit, like me or Sandra or Phyllis or any of the women that have been through this shit? And you know how much fucking men play a part in our fucking drug use and our destruction of ourselves?
So all I'm talking about now is a kind of way of understanding what we mean by community as method. It's when the community is the total context to be used by the individual to change themselves, when the community is setting the expectations about how individuals participate to change themselves, when the community is constantly evaluating and assessing whether the client is changing, and when the community responds to the individual in terms of whether they're changing. Now, typically, for example, in therapeutic communities, the kind of response that the community will make will be often in positive terms because the individual is meeting expectations. They're involved in the group and they are participating in meetings and so on. The community, individual members, may in fact deliver positive responses, what we call affirmations. You're really working this program. You're really behaving as a role model, as a positive affirmation. If the client essentially is displaying some non-participatory behavior, a peer member may in fact confront the individual that you've been sitting back, you've been here for 2 months, you haven't done anything, you don't get up much in the morning meeting, you don't talk to new residents, you don't talk very much in groups.
You are not working this program. You're not. Okay, you're not dropping slips in groups. I don't really see you participating that much, Karen. You're like in the woodwork. Like, don't see me, don't call me, you know, and I call on you because I want you. I'm trying to, you know, help you to get this program, but this is your program and you're not working it.
That constant feedback ultimately expresses the idea that the community is providing responses to the individual participation based on the community's observation about whether the individual is meeting expectations. If in fact the behaviors become much more serious behaviors, like the individual may be engaging in rule-breaking behavior, and staff need to deal with that, the staff response might be disciplinary sanctions. Or if the client is showing excellent commitment to change and working at the program, meeting expectations, there'll be increased privileges as a positive response from the community delivered by staff.
You got more privileges now, right?
Oh, okay.
Laundry room by yourself. You
all
can
right,
go to the phone.
Thank you, guys.
Use of working out.
Okay, thank you.
Corner trips with escort, library trips with escort.
So that basically then community as method really refers to the idea that there's a context in the community. The community is the context. The community sets expectations. The community continually evaluates whether you're meeting it, and they'll continually respond to those evaluations in positive and with positive or negative consequences. Let's speak in a little bit more detail about each of the four components of community as method. The first, when we talked about community as the context, we really mean that it consists of all of the elements. By context, we mean all of the elements: the program structure, the daily regimen of activities, the social relationships, which are all used as tools for self-change. And you know, the fundamental assumption around this idea of community as context, which is one component of the method, is that individuals obtain maximum therapeutic and educational impact when they participate fully as members in the community. That is, when they use the context, the community elements, as tools for self-change. That fundamental assumption has this idea of context and participation. Context and participation, using the primary elements. And in typical therapeutic communities, varieties of groups, varieties of meetings, a work structure, resident work structure, seminars, teaching sessions, informal relationships with both other peers as well as staff, and the multiple social roles that we talked about a little earlier in terms of, let's say, like expediters and coordinators and friendships and so on. The point about context is, here is everything that we do, and what the community is saying is, if you participate in all of these, you will then change. So the key is the context and the participation. But let's go to expectations, about exactly what they really mean by expectations. And when we talk about that, you know, because you're living 24 hours, 7 days a week for many months, perhaps, in therapeutic community programs, wide varieties of behaviors essentially will be displayed, and there are going to be expectancies about all of those, particularly if they reflect characteristics of the disorder. One way we've summarized therapeutic community expectations, or if you like, expectations as part of community as method, is that these standards that the membership sets concerning the goals of participation can be described as follows. And I'm summarizing now a lot of information, but each of these is headed by a kind of concept word. Community expects that you will change through performance. Everything you do should be done 150%. So if it's in your job function, if it's participating in the meetings, if it's participating in groups, if it's learning how to deliver feedback to other residents and so on, the expectation of the community is you will do it 150%. That is, you will fully participate all the minutes that you're in the program. It's an idealized expectation. But again, it's emphasizing this very important assumption that if the client participates, they will change. So therefore, one of the expectations is constantly to remind the client that they've got to participate 150%. And do it all right. There's more to the idea of expectation around performance, because we know that our clients, as part of their disorder, have rarely essentially invested 150% of their energy in anything, except perhaps learning how to buy drugs and use drugs. So that one of the characteristics of the individual, namely completing things, working at things, and doing things 100% and not trying to skirt around things and do things halfway or try to do it the easy way out, which characterizes a lot of our clients. Those characteristics, in many ways, can be summarized as the way individuals have performed in life.
If you trusted me, then you'd learn to regret it later on. If you believe something that I said, you'd learn to, to regret that later on. Because if I came and said that I needed something or that I was in a problem, and 9 out of 10, I was conning and I was manipulating just to get whatever I needed.
And now that the community sets an expectation about 150% performance, it's directly addressing those characteristics. And so, as we'll see in a moment, when the individual is not meeting those expectations, it's not only that they are essentially displaying the fact that we're not meeting the expectations of the community, but in many ways they may be displaying standard characteristics that they have, which is really never to really perform at 150%. So one area of expectation is that we monitor, that is, the community monitors as individual moves through treatment, is whether individuals are really performing 150% and doing everything the right way and with all of the energy and all of the right attitude. Secondly, community has expectations around the concept of responsibility. We expect that as individuals move through a program, when I say we, I mean the community, as they move through a program, that their level of responsibility, responsibility means to respond to, their level of responsibility begins to widen.
Coordinating is your top of the house. You make sure everybody is doing their job, like the chief motivators, the motivators, the phase board, the kitchen heads. You make sure that everybody is doing what they're supposed to be doing in the TC.
For example, when you first come into the program, we expect you to take care of your own physical space and your own psychological space. Keep yourself clean, keep your room clean, making sure you show up on time and are punctual at meetings and so on in groups. Basically being responsible to yourself. That's early in the program. As you move through the program, community expectation begins to ask a little bit more of you. Be responsible for your peers. So it's not only your physical and psychological space that we're asking you to be responsible for, but now observe your peers and take responsibility for whether they are, in fact, trying to meet their own responsibility around physical and psychological space.
No matter what goes on in the house, I'm able to pull the person up on it or take it to staff if it needs to go to staff, no matter what, and not, you know, have any animosity towards the person or the person have animosity to me.
So program expectation is you move from responsibility to yourself to responsibility for your peers. Now, of course, there's a rather deep and a rather profound social psychological set of principles that are operating here, which is when, in fact, I'm taking responsibility for your behavior and attitudes by reminding you about how to behave, I'm reinforcing the correct behavior and attitudes in myself. So that, again, it's not altruistic. And it's very mutual, but it's not altruistic. But the responsibility level is I'm obligated. Brother, sister's keeper, for example, a phrase used in therapeutic communities, a biblical phrase used in therapeutic communities, captures the idea of being responsible for your peer. And we expect that as you move through the program, you move from responsibility to yourself to including responsibility for your peers. But again, with this important proviso that in being responsible for the peers, you're also learning ways to reinforce the proper behaviors and attitudes in yourself. There's a third level of responsibility, though, that programs essentially, or community as method, implies, and that is, as you move through the program, we expect that your responsibility level will increase to the general community. So that as clients now have learned to take care of themselves and meet their obligations themselves, have become obligated to essentially observe their peers, they're now essentially obligated to see how this general community, the whole community, if you like, is essentially functioning. Is this a healthy community? Is the mood right? Is the attitude right? Is the community itself, the whole collectivity, is it doing what it needs to be doing? So as individuals move through this community, the expectation is you will take on more and more responsibility for the entire management of this community and the health of this community under the supervision of staff. Well, you notice that what we're talking about is an increasing level of responsibility. Now, of course, this big area of responsibility that we've broken out into kind of three levels, really in the last analysis addresses a fundamental characteristic of the client, which is they have not been responsible. And so that you now give them an entire social structure where you set up an expectation about how they should be responsible within that social structure, you are actually providing a clear pathway for them to learn responsibility.
Holding other people accountable, putting my nose in other people's business. It's easy for me to just, if I see somebody doing something, you know, mind my own business. And to go outside of that, which you have to do around here, you have to pull people up and, you know, you have to stick your nose in other people's business, so that puts me in conflict a lot of times.
And at every step of the way, the community has not only set that expectation, but as you'll see in a moment, they're constantly observing whether you're meeting that expectation. The third component that defines community as method is this, the phrase community assesses whether the client is meeting expectation. Now, the various ways that community does that is in some ways first initially by simply exposure. A new resident comes into treatment and they see groups, they see meetings, and the expectation is that the client will essentially pay attention to what is going on.
It should be DTFs that are coming in and people who have just walked through the door viewing the elders in the house giving support so that they can follow suit.
That's how the newcomers come in with, that's how the newcomers get to start doing support by watching some of the elders.
They watch you. They watch you.
So the expectation is quite modest. It simply says, if you're a new resident, we want you to pay attention to what's going on in groups. We want you to pay attention as to how meetings unfold. And then, of course, if the resident is not meeting that expectation, the community is going to respond to that. So initially, one of the strategies that a community assesses whether the client is meeting expectations is just exposure, you know what I mean, and saying, this is what you should do. You should pay attention. The second level is to literally instruct them. This is how you do something. And then we assess if we've taught the individual how they should participate in the group, how they should participate in the meeting, then we expect them to participate in the way that we've taught them.
Yeah. Okay, we don't attack people's inborn dignity. Somebody want to tell me what inborn dignity is? Thomas?
Loss of an arm, loss of hearing, some type of disability the person has.
Okay, inborn. Okay, it could be the color of their skin. Somebody wears glasses, Ruben?
Yeah, something that they can't change.
Something about themselves that they can't change, because what we seek to do in the encounter is deal with people's behavior. I can't change the color of my skin. I can't change my eye, my vision problems. But I can change my behavior.
So a third way then is to test them. You got exposure, you got teach, instruct. Then a third way is test. An individual has learned something. We already know that they know how to do this. And if we now change the job function for them, or increase if the staff person essentially moves them up and gives them a greater level of, let's say, work responsibility. The expectation is we're going to see now how they actually handle the increased level of responsibility. So it's a kind of testing strategy, which basically constantly gives the community an opportunity to evaluate whether the client is meeting expectations. Then finally, a very dramatic way is the one that I've added, which is the term challenge the individual, which is a little bit more than testing. Testing means you know how to do this, and let's see now how you really do it. Challenge says, I'll put you in a totally new situation where you may not know about this. In classical long-term therapeutic communities, for example, clients who were, let's say, became very good at working in the maintenance crew in therapeutic communities might then suddenly get a job change which put them into administration or personnel or purchasing. A whole new set of skills, tasks, and people. And of course, the expectation here is the individual is going to adapt and cope in somehow some kind of mature way to the new situation if they've actually learned anything while they've been through treatment. Well, that's an example of challenging the individual in terms of, I'll put you in a new situation entirely and see how you really handle that. The expectation is that hopefully you will handle it in a mature way. So that we're constantly, in community as method, evaluating whether individuals are meeting certain expectations through exposure, teaching, testing, and challenging. And then, of course, the everyday activity involved, which is an evaluation activity, is when clients are simply observing each other's behaviors and attitudes on a daily basis. And as you'll see, as I talk about in a moment, and then finally providing feedback, which is actually a way of talking about community response. And that's the fourth component of community as method, and that is when we are looking at your behavior and attitudes in terms of whether it meets expectations, and then respond to whether you are or you're not meeting it. Now, essentially, a kind of good way to understand this is that there are two broad ways in which the community responds to the whole issue of expectation, whether a client's meeting expectation. One is, it may provide supportive, affirmative responses to the individual. Namely, the individual is showing attitudes and behavior change which meets the expectations of the community. You're really participating in group. You're really pulling in new residents. You're really dealing with staff and others with great respect. In other words, essentially displaying the kind of behavior and attitudinal change that we want people to display. And when they're doing that, we give them feedback on that.
I want to give you a push-up. You know, we've all been sitting here going over your week, and you did a really wonderful job. Something you can be proud of yourself for.
Just want to, you know, affirm you on your enthusiasm, you know, and your genuine, you know, desire to get all you can out of this, you know. I really, you know, we've been talking, you know, you've always been helpful, you know, helpful to me, you know. Just want to affirm you, Joe, you know, for your enthusiasm, you know, to try to get yourself together. And, you know, you seem like you're not taking anything for granted.
That might be positive affirmation feedback, which is essentially designed, of course, to reinforce the client in their positive change. Or supportive, which is a little bit different than affirmation. Supportive is simply keep doing it. Affirmation is you're doing very well. And that's a kind of fine-grained distinction, but it is important because sometimes the individual may not be doing it quite well, but what we want to do is essentially support their effort in doing this. The second class, though, of community responses, primarily these are all peer membership responses to each other. On a daily basis, we expect people to provide affirmation and supportive statements to each other. That requires that we're constantly looking at each other's behavior and attitudes, so those affirmations and supportive statements have credibility. But the second class is essentially responses to clients who are not meeting expectations in one way or another, maybe as frankly as rule-breaking behavior, but more simply as, you know, displaying attitudes that are very reminiscent of the negative attitudes on the street and so on, so that we expect that the individual will essentially not display those attitudes, and when they do, the response is often corrective. I'm not talking about punitive, I said corrective. And that is when an individual is essentially not meeting expectations, showing a rather negative attitude, being indifferent, not participating 100%, and so on, then the peers, or one peer or other peers, may in fact essentially respond to that and say, point out something about the individual's behavior and attitudes and whether they're participating, whether they're performing, whether they're taking responsibility, and so on.
She has gotten really pissed off at her for telling her the truth.
Yeah.
Why?
Because
what did you tell her that pissed her off so much?
The writer kid.
I tell her the truth.
What?
She's talking about gangbanging. And I tell her about her kids. I tell her to write her kids. I tell her to sit down, write her social worker. I tell her because she's young. I get on her and tell her, you know, don't wait till she gets my age. She's 45 because she's young. Write her children. Send them letters. You know, do things that are positive. Don't be going out there hanging on the yard with that BS, you know, because it's not cool. And I'm always riding on her. We're roommates. It's three of us in here that are roommates.
Manny, we got on her in a group not too long ago about the gang banging, you know, because she still hangs on to some of her old friends and she was going to the yard and stuff. So we got on her in the group telling her that that's not good, whatever. And she, it took her a minute. She fought us off.
Right?
Yeah,
she
but I don't know that she's finding a
man. Look at the face you're making.
Yeah,
So the community response is, of course, the fourth component to community as method. Now think about this. If we're talking about in the first analysis treatment and treatment of a whole person disorder, and then we're going to use a community and living in the community as the primary approach in to essentially implement the treatment goal, which is to change the whole person. You can now see why, if I've got a whole person and I've got a community, we have the relationship between what I would call a multi-interventional approach, the use of the whole community, essentially setting expectations, responding to the individual on a daily basis, positively reinforcing, correcting the individual. You got a multi-interventional approach to deal with a multi-dimensional disorder. And so that community as method is one of the real achievements of the therapeutic community. How to use a community in a methodological way in order to bring about the kind of long-term treatment effect that we're interested in.